keeping yourselves out of situations. You know, there's all kinds of ungodly stuff on TV and movies and music and, you know, shut it off. You know, if you, like I said, you can't be tempted by what you don't think. If stuff get, you know, ends up in your mind, you know what to do with, you know, imaginations that go against godly ideas or principles. You know, we have the armor of God. 2 Corinthians 10, 4 and 5. You know, if the strongholds are there, if you are in a situation where thoughts are coming, well, cast them down. That's, you might have to be so-called violent about it.
Amen.
You know, talk to the devil, put him in his place. Do what it takes just to replace those thoughts with godly thoughts.
Amen.
Until our minds are renewed and we realize the authority we have, that's something that we wouldn't even think of doing, but we have the authority. Yes. We're seated with Christ above all principalities and powers, right?
Amen. Amen.
We don't need to put up with negative thoughts, negative attitudes. I mean, it all ties in also to our hearts and attitudes and things, which is too much to go into at this point, but casting down imaginations and everything that exalts itself against the knowledge of God, and bringing into captivity every thought to the obedience of Christ. James 4, 7 and 8 says, submit yourselves therefore to God, resist the devil, and he will flee from you. Cast those thoughts down and resist the devil. And, you know, it may not be easy. You may have to, like I said, get a little violent, talk to the devil, put him in his place, but the victory is yours.
Amen.
I mean, we're standing in the place of victory.
Trying. Amen.
We're not struggling to beat the devil. He's already defeated.
Yeah.
If you realize that, it's, there's no contest, right?
Amen.
You know, the walk isn't an easy walk.
Amen.
Fight the good fight of faith, I think. It is a good fight. Draw nigh to God, he will draw nigh to you. What's spending time in the Word doing for you? Draw nigh to God. He is right there. He said he'll never leave us or forsake us, but we need to seek him.
That's right.
Cleanse your hands, ye sinners, and purify your hearts, ye double-minded. That double-mindedness that kind of reminds me of where I was at, thinking of the Lord here and there, but not really. Then next thing you know, I was holding by the world. And you know, it took many years to break that, but it was only the Lord drawing in his goodness and mercy. I just, you know, looking back, I just can't believe it. What the Lord, how good he has been to me. So if you're on the fence, don't wait another second.
Amen.
Don't wait another second. I think I'll I'll wrap it up here and... One more scripture and just a few more comments, and if we could, you know, queue up a song, that'd be cool. Philippians 4:8, finally, brethren, whatsoever things are true, whatsoever things are honest, whatsoever things are just, whatsoever things are pure, whatsoever things are lovely, whatsoever things are of good report, if there be any virtue, if there be any praise, think on these things. You know, just this has really been on my heart is, you know, renewing of the mind, our thoughts, how we deal with.
Amen.
Until we have a renewed mind, that, you know, we can't live out the perfect will of God in our
Amen.
Lives.
Amen. Mm-hmm. Amen.
You know, there's kingdom business to do, and we can't, you know, we can't take things lightly, what the world's throwing at us. We have to focus in on the Lord, because He's got great things for each and every one of us.
Amen. Amen.
And I just thank God, you know, for the strength that He's given me to talk to you today. I mean, again, this is a basically a testimony and breaking through, and just you know, breaking the strongholds, and the Lord is doing that in my life. And there's more, and I'm open to Him. Just keep working, Lord.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Yes, Lord.
Yes, Lord.
Yes, Lord.
Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Yes, Jesus.
You have the ability to choose your thoughts and what you focus on.
Yes.
Take your thoughts captive.
Yes.
Amen. Yes. It's not an option. Guard your heart. Sow the word into your life. Walk in the liberty Christ has purchased for us. Make time for the Lord and meditate in His word. We know the truth will set us free, right? You know, let's think about things like, I'm forgiven, I'm cleansed. I am the righteousness of God in Christ
Amen.
Jesus.
Amen.
I can do all things through
yes.
Christ who strengthens
yes.
me.
Yes.
The power that raised Christ up from the dead lives in me. Thank you, Lord.
Amen. Thank you, Jesus.
I'd like us to just... lift up a praise to the Lord. There's a song I want Mike to cue up, and
all right.
maybe focus in on the words, and just I hope it blesses you. Even though it's, you know, so to speak, frightening for me to be up here.
You call me from
this is blessing you, so enjoy. Praise the Lord.
You call me out on my shame. The new has come. Now I have resurrection power. Then on the inside, Jesus, you have given us freedom. No longer bound by sin and darkness. Living in the light of your goodness, you have given us freedom.
Hallelujah, hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus.
One thing I'd like to say that while Kevin was speaking to us today, and he was talking about being shy.
I gotta
tell you one little story. I went into the Army, and I was in Washington, D.C., Arlington, Virginia, and I didn't know anybody. So I'm walking down Pershing Drive. You can sit down. I'm walking down Pershing Drive, and I'm a little self-conscious even telling you about this. I'm walking down Pershing Drive. And I'm thinking, because I was always shy. I was really shy. And I have a tendency to be shy now. You won't believe that.
No, we don't.
But as I'm walking down Pershing Drive, I'm thinking, I remember looking over at the apartment buildings, looking at this little strip mall that I was walking by. And I was thinking, nobody knows me here. Not one person knows me. That was a really great thought, because nobody knows a thing about me. So, I don't need to be shy anymore. Because they don't know that I'm shy, and I built this pattern with the people that I live with in my church, the church that I went to. I live a certain way because I lock, just by living, you become a certain behavior pattern.
Right.
And everybody expects you to be that. So, if you're shy, you don't want to draw any attention to yourself to be different from what you were all this time. So you have to break away from that. So, I have never even had a date once in my life. I'm like, I don't know how. 22 years old, 21 years old. I never had a date. I never went to anything at the school other than school things like class and programs. I went to some football games, you know, but mostly playing in the band. And so I said, nobody knows that I'm shy. Nobody knows that I have never had a date. No. If I want to have a date, I could have one, you know? And I found out a little bit more. This all comes in layers, you know? I found out a little bit more about who I am. And I found out that I had a great mom, a wonderful. See, we'll end up with this one. This thought. I had a great mom who put God in my life. She loved God. She took me to church on Sunday morning. We did not miss. We did not miss a service. Sunday night, we drove all the way back to home. Sunday night, we drove all the way back to the church. We were there. You know, I never had a date and went on to a dance with a girl. But I went to a dance. It was in the church. Holy Ghost would move. And the whole church would dance.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
I'm serious.
Amen.
You know,
amen.
I have never gotten drunk on wine or any kind of thing. Though my dad drank 14 bottles of beer every night, 18 on Friday and 24 on Saturday and 24 on Sunday. I'm not exaggerating, this is the truth. But I went to a place where there were drunks.
Hallelujah.
They were all in the church.
Hallelujah.
I saw young people so drunk they couldn't stand up. They couldn't stand up. The parents had to carry them to the car to take them home after Sunday night service. There was dancing. There was drinking of the wine of the Spirit. And they were so, I mean, this is what life is. It's what life was. It is what life is. Praise God. And so nobody knew me in Washington, D.C., but I needed help to know what to do. I went to a phone book. I had the number of the pastor. Nobody knew me. I didn't have to call the pastor. I didn't have to go to church anymore if I didn't want to. But my mom put it in me. And Tuesday night we went to church to Bible study. And Thursday night we went to church. And sometimes Saturday. And sometimes we went to church every night for 8 weeks straight. Not one break. Plus Sunday morning, Sunday school and all that. Somebody put something into me. That always bring me back. No matter how far. No matter how bad I was, my behavior. No matter how wrong. Always drew me back.
Yes. Amen.
And I give the credit to my mom.
Yes. Amen.
She worked a job. She drove. She was the first woman school bus driver in the state of Michigan. They had to put wood pedals, wood pieces of wood on the pedals so she could push down the gas pedal in the bus. She was so small. She would drive that big bus. And she would work hard, and she would fix meals, and she, what kind of a person is this? And the other day, I was reading From Egypt to Canaan, written by my mom, 60 pages of Bible study about the tabernacle in the wilderness.
Yes.
I never grieved. When my mom died, I never grieved. I missed my mom.
Yeah.
I like to call her up right now. I'd call her up right now. Yeah. And I'd put her on speaker and everybody could hear her. But she drove around in a bus and when it was a foggy day and she said, "You stack the Spirit of the Lord is everywhere, just like this fog, driving around in the Spirit of the Lord." I would come down the stairs and be 11 o'clock at night, 12 o'clock at night. She had to be up driving a bus early in the morning. We never missed church. We never missed church. I'm stressing this because I think some of us miss church.
Right.
I think it's a bad practice.
Right.
I would come down the stairway and I would hear this little voice, this quiet voice. And I realized my mom, she was praying. I'm here because my mom brought me to God. My dad finally, he put his packs of cigarettes, Lucky Strikes, unfiltered Lucky Strikes, on the top of his dresser.
Yeah.
And he said, I'm quitting smoking. And he quit drinking and smoking. Why did he do that? Because my mom introduced him to the Lord Jesus Christ.
Amen.
Yeah.
Amen.
Amen.
And I was there the day that my dad came in.
Amen.
It was a black woman minister
Hallelujah.
That was preaching in our
Hallelujah.
Church.
Hallelujah.
And my dad was so prejudiced against black people. And I heard him speaking in tongues so loud, my dad was the quietest person on earth.
Okay? Yes.
Until you get him on a roll. But anyway, he was shy. He was speaking so loud you could hear him all over the whole church, speaking in tongues. Just zippity-doo-dah. I mean, it was coming out of him.
Hallelujah.
And he went over and he grabbed that black woman evangelist and he gave her the biggest hug. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Yeah.
God took away his wrong attitude.
Right.
Right.
Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen.
Why? Because my mom introduced him.
Amen.
Yep.
Hallelujah. My sister ran away from home at 14 with the guy that she's still married to. She was 14 years old. She ran away with Rudy Strauss. But something drew Rudy Strauss into the Lord.
Yeah. Yeah.
He received the Holy Ghost, speaking in tongues, and he was baptized in Jesus' name. And they told him, you must go into the army for the next 2 years because it beats going to jail. And if you still want to marry each other, well, have at it. And they're still married to this day. But it's because of God in their life.
Amen.
Amen.
So I do want to wish you a happy Mother's Day.
Yes.
Brandy, you have a big job.
Yeah.
The most important job in the world. You and your husband. You're saving some people. Hallelujah.
Amen.
And so are.
Amen.
So I know these kids, there's going to be something for mom. Are we going to